It's become well known that one in two people may develop some type of cancer over their lifetime. Brighton is very lucky to have a Macmillan Horizon Centre, which provides a range of services for patients living with cancer. I spoke with Geoff Brown, the centre manager, to find out more about these services. Geoff, thank you very much for talking to Latest TV. So we were here at the very start of in terms of the construction of the Macmillan Horizon Centre, and it's great to see it grow from strength to strength. Can you tell us a bit about what's happened over the last 7 years?
So the centre opened in November 2016, and over the last 7.5 years, it's really, really grown and developed in the way that we always hoped it would. So we've grown the number of volunteers. I think when we initially started, we had about 70 volunteers helped us get it started, and we now have over 140 volunteers. And the volunteers are at the heart of what we offer, all trained, qualified to do what they do. And we've developed and expanded a range of services. Of course, in the middle of that period, we had COVID and the lockdown, and that also involved us developing some new services, because we had to shift from everything being here at the centre to everything being online. And we developed a number of online services, and we've actually been able to carry on quite a few of those afterwards. So we have a few things that we do that people don't have to come here to access, and that's great, because people don't have to worry about travelling in here or parking, and they're able to access those support services. We've also increased the range of other services that we have here at the centre as well, and we've formed a couple of partnerships with organisations, the Trust for Developing Communities and Hangleton Knoll Foundation, and that they're working with them to actually go out into the community, so that we're reaching the people that aren't maybe coming here. So this year we've really been focusing on Whitehawk, and we've started regular sessions up at the food bank there, and also in a community centre, and really working with the GP practice there to link with people to make sure they're aware about what's available at the centre, and we're going to go forward looking at other geographical communities and also other communities of identity where people maybe aren't coming to the centre as much. So we're sort of moving on, and we've also really been doing more work to support the development of support across Sussex as well. So we've particularly been working in East Sussex, looking at Eastbourne and Hastings, and working to work out what people affected by cancer in those areas would like to see develop. And we're hoping in June we'll be opening up a new community hub in Hastings Town Centre, and also looking to open more information and support access in Eastbourne as well. And in March, Macmillan opened a new information area at Worthing Hospital as well. So the vision always was that this was, although it was a building in Brighton, it was a service here for people across Sussex. And that didn't mean that we expected everybody in Sussex to come here, but we wanted to use this as a sort of a bit of a catalyst and the energy from here to be able to think about how we could develop more services nearer to where people were as well.
And you're beside the Sussex Cancer Centre that delivers the diagnosis and treatment for patients with cancer. And of course that is moving to a new site eventually on the Royal Sussex County site. Can you tell us a bit more how you work together with the Sussex Cancer Centre?
So we work closely with the Sussex Cancer Centre, and one of the things we've been anticipating is this move, and at the moment they're just knocking down the old building, and then I think it's still going to take 2 or 3 years before the new building is there, so it takes time, because it includes both mainly the treatment side, so radiotherapy and chemotherapy, and they're going to bring together a lot of the things that are now like haematology that are in different places. So it will be a bigger centre than the current one, and obviously built now rather than years ago. So it will be a great improvement for people. One of the impacts for us will be that it will actually then be at the other side of the hospital, because the current Sussex Cancer Centre is exactly over the road, and people often might drop in here when they've got appointments there. And where they go there, they can't help but really see this building. So we've been anticipating that by starting to do more, have more volunteers going out there in outreach roles, So we have volunteers who go in information support role into chemotherapy and into the outpatient clinic and onto some of the wards. And they're there to provide a listening ear and support to people and just do some signposting, make sure people are aware of what support is available. And one of the reasons for doing that is that when those functions move, our volunteers will be able to move with them, so that when it moves across the road, we'll still be able to have volunteers there to tell people about what support's available and make sure they're able to access that support. And we found that has been very effective, because previously we did have posters and we make sure everybody gets a leaflet in the information they get, but people get a lot of information. People get quite blind to posters, and we found actually the most effective is to have a person there in a Macmillan t-shirt, and people recognise the brand and can approach them and talk to them, and that's been really effective. And that's been one of the reasons we've seen post-COVID, we've really put a lot of effort into that, and we now have about 20 volunteers who go into the hospital, to different areas of the hospital, to provide support, rather than expecting people to come to us. And we've had we're the busiest that we've ever been with the number of people coming in here. So the first quarter of this year, we had 30% more people registering with us than the first quarter of last year. And that's really, I think, to a large degree, to us getting a lot better and doing more and having more capacity to make sure people are aware about the support that is available.
And the types of support that you offer, it's financial, emotional. Can you go into more detail about
So we have a wide range of support. So the first thing is, if people just come into the centre, they come into an information lounge, and there we have a range of leaflets and information available. Usually a couple of volunteers are based there, and they would greet people and just chat to people. And we have a process of registration where people can talk to the volunteers and they will explain what happens in the building, and people can decide which or whatever support that would be suitable to them. And that sometimes people just aren't aware of what's available, so it's a process of talking that through and making sure that they are aware. The space itself is part of what we offer as well, so people can just come in and use that space. They help have a tea or coffee and just relax. If you've had a long day supporting somebody who's in chemotherapy, it's nice to be able to come over here and just have a sit for a while. Or if you, as a patient, you've arrived a bit early, it's a nice space to come to. So then we offer a range of therapies. So we have a range of complementary therapies. So that's things like massage, aromatherapy, Reiki, reflexology, acupuncture. And the important word there is complementary. So they're not alternative therapies. They're really there to complement the healthcare that people are getting. And the main focus is helping people cope with some of the impact of the treatment, which could be stress and or can be things like hot flushes and fatigue and just generally feeling tired. So things like acupuncture can help with that, or a massage. Sometimes after surgery, people have maybe got limited movement. So if you've had your lymph nodes removed, it's difficult to reach up. So a massage can really help people to relax some of the muscles and help recover. So it's a very important service, and we offer people up to 6 appointments for free. We'd love to be able to offer more, but the demand is such that that's the only way we can make it more equitable, so that more people can access that service. And it gives people a chance to try it, and if it works for them, then they can go out into the community and find those services, although that does cost more. So we also have counselling services as well. So like the complementary therapies, they're delivered by volunteers, but they're fully trained and qualified volunteers. People who are often have their own practice and maybe are volunteering here once a week in addition. So the counselling is very important. We have 2 services that we provide here. One is run through the NHS, so through the University Hospital Sussex, and one is run through us, both Macmillan branded services. The trust one is really supporting people who are actively going through treatment and up to 6 months afterwards. And that's because at that time, what people are worried about might be their health issues that are going on. And it's really helpful for the counsellors to have access to that information and understand that. Whereas the people that the service we're running directly ourselves supports people after they finish their treatment. And for a lot of people, that can be very different. When your treatment's finished, people sometimes talk about almost like they've fallen off a cliff. They've had a structure of appointments, so they've always known they've got somebody to talk to in a week or in a few weeks or a month, and then that just suddenly stops, and you're told to come back for a checkup maybe once a year or once every 6 months, and people can feel like they've just been dropped, and also that can be really the time when you've moved beyond the immediate medical worries to have more time to sort of think about the emotional impact of what you've been through, and particularly to think about your own expectations of life, how long you might live, and how the kind of life you might lead. So that's a really useful time for people to be able to access those counselling services. And we have some of those counsellors who do like a twilight shift, so from 5 till 8, 9 o'clock, and that means that that means we can make that available for people who've returned to work as well, so they don't have to take time off to work to come to some of those appointments. So we offer some other, with a partner in the NHS and ourselves, some other physical emotional wellbeing support as well. So we run a course called HOPE, which stands for Help Overcoming Problems Effectively. That's a 6-week course that people can do 2 hours a week. And it really helps people as a group to think about how they can move on beyond their treatment. We also have meditation sessions, and later this year we're hoping to set up a mindfulness session as well. And running opportunities for people to think about how they move beyond their treatment. So we run a number of health and wellbeing sessions. So they're split into different focuses. So we have one session that focuses on emotional well-being, one that focuses on food and eating well to feel better, and one that's more about physical activity and fatigue. And they're workshops where people get a chance to meet with other people, and also they're facilitated to think about how to feel better through eating well or being more active as well. Short walk 3 times a week, and then developing some targets over a year to think about how to become more active, because it will help with your recovery. They also will see people before, because they do some what's called prehab support, so to help people if they're going to have surgery, how to become a bit fitter, because that will help you cope with the surgery and help you recover from it as well.
This is a huge array of services.
Yeah, haven't finished
You've not
yet.
Drawn breath yet.
No. So we also have a cafe at the centre, and that's a very key part of what we offer. So the cafe is because for a lot of people they have a long day, so it's somewhere just to come to get something to eat and drink. When the centre was open, there wasn't much on this side of the hospital. With the new building, there is more available there. But still, it's people have to go round, but it's much easier to pop over here. But the other big thing about the cafe is it's a shorthand for the nursing team to encourage people to come into the centre. And we do find that a lot of people will sort of self-exclude themselves from accessing support. They'll say, oh, that's for other people, that's not for me. But if they're told there's a cafe here, I don't know, they wouldn't say, oh, no, a cup of tea is not for me. they'll come in and get a cup of tea or a coffee. And when they do that, then they'll have a chance to find out about what else is here, and we'll encourage them to think about that. So we have a card that we give to new patients that gives them a free coffee, and we have a barista coffee here, so it's nice coffee that we have. And we have, it's a simple cafe, so it's sandwiches made on site with soup and jacket potatoes and other snacks, and there's also a chance if patients come in there, then they know the other people in there are also patients. So we often find that people come in, if they come in by themselves, they'll often end up asking, oh, is it okay if I sit here, and starting chatting to somebody else. So they get a lot of support that way. And through the cafe, we also run some cookery workshops as well. So helping people to think about, again, how to eat well and feel better, particularly encouraging people to find ways to eat more protein. So that helps them to keep up their energy levels, particularly while they're going through chemotherapy. And last year, through the cafe, we also started a community garden that we have up at Five Ways, so near the children's centre up there. And that's a great, we run during this over the summer months, so just started, not quite the summer yet, but just started a weekly session. And as that gets busier, we'll do twice a week of gardening up there. And we get very positive feedback from that as well, particularly people maybe who've got, haven't really got much of a garden themselves, and it's a really nice space to go up there. And we have four volunteers who really keep it in. They do all the hard work, and then people can join them and do some of the more fun part of gardening as well. And we're looking at other things we can do up in that space, because it because of the location, it shares the view with, so you can see the sea and the wind farm, which is what you can see from here as well. And also it's up on the ridge, so there's a little walk you can do along the ridge without having to climb a hill. You get the advantage of being up high and seeing the view. So we're looking at doing some maybe walk and talk counselling sessions up there as well. So the centre is also used by a wide range of support groups. So I think you might have spoken to some people from the ovarian cancer support group.
Yes.
And we have other tumour-based support groups, so prostate cancer support group, breast cancer support group, bladder cancer support group. Also some more generic groups. So we have a men's group that meets here. And they usually have about 12 to 15 people come along and talk to each other. We started the men's group through some volunteers who very kindly facilitate that a couple of years ago. And like many organisations working in health and social care, we find that 70% of the people that take advantage of what we can offer are women and 30% are men. That's actually the same statistic for the Macmillan support line, the phone line, which is a great service people can also use. And we would encourage people that our phone, and the national phone line is open 7 days a week from 8 till 8. So if we're not open, then please do call the national number. And also there's lots of resources on our website. But the support groups meet here and they use either the space we're in now, which is an activity-based room, or the main lounge that we have downstairs. And as I was saying, we've also tried to think about how to encourage more men to access our support. And that was not one of the groups that we were expecting when I said we were doing more work to think about parts of the community that weren't coming here.
Yes.
And how to encourage them to come here. So we weren't sure if the support group for men would attract people, but it has. But we're also looking to do more to try and get more men. So we have one of the services I haven't mentioned, a hairdressing service. And just the language, we found that many men think hairdressing is that sounds like something for women. So we're trying to develop more a barber service as well, or just try to make it clearer that the hairdressing service is for anybody that wants to access it as well. So.
Very impressive list of services. And lastly, do you find that people's needs are changing over time with different therapies, different treatments such as immunotherapies, for instance?
Yes, I think people it is changing, but some things aren't changing as well. And one of the things that we find often when people have their appointment, they're told this diagnosis, and it's very difficult to keep listening and hearing what you're being told, because you're thinking about the implications of that diagnosis. So you're thinking about your partner, your family, your children, what's going to happen, all the things that you hope to do. So I think what we still find is people find it helpful to come in here to get a bit of a reiteration of what they've heard, and to have a chance to really process that, which is why we emphasise to our volunteers that one of the training we offer to them is around listening and responding, and really emphasising the value of active listening and understanding that even though you might not feel you're telling somebody much, just giving them a chance to talk to you and process how they're feeling and what they've been told is really valuable. And that's part of what we hope we offer to people, is a space where they can come and talk things through for themselves and understand what it means and help themselves move on. One of the services we're hoping to start later this year is a health and wellbeing coaching service. And we've been really lucky. Macmillan did a pilot and then for various reasons didn't continue that. But we've been able to tap into the coaches that were recruited. And we now have 15 new volunteers who are going to join us. And that will be a virtual service as well. So people will be able to access that without needing to come here.
Right.
And the other great thing about that is that the volunteers aren't also from Brighton. They're from all over the world, actually. We have one who's in Australia and mostly around the UK. And that's the other one of the strands we really hope to reinforce coming out of COVID and the learning we had about what we can offer in terms of virtual support. So we have a breathing workshop and yoga workshop, and we run a weekly session called Horizon Connect that is an online session that anybody can be sent the link to, and they can join up, and it's facilitated by two of the team here. And just really giving chance to people to meet other people and to feel connected at a time when you can feel quite isolated and alone.